We have a good 6-7 inches of snow, but the dishy is looking okay. Hi folks, welcome back. This is part two of my Starlink videos. Had a great response to the last video. If you haven't seen it yet, check it out, the link up here. In this video, I'm going to cover all the frequently asked questions that people asked in the 2,000 plus comments that I've got on the last video. We've had the Starlink for about 5 weeks now. It's been performing well on the whole. Speeds are still really good. The short outages have decreased a little bit, but we're still seeing 15 second or so outages every so often. And we're still seeing once in a while a longer outage in the middle of the night. First things first, I did not cut this tree to put the Starlink dish here. Tons of people have asked about data caps, and right now in the public beta, there are no data caps. This is unlimited internet. Another really common question was, how does the Starlink do during bad weather? In clouds like we have today, or in rain, or in snow? I took some footage of me out here in the heavy rain, and it was working fine. I'll put some of that footage in here. This past week, we got about 7 inches of snow in 6 hours, and the dish kept itself clear. It actually generates enough heat that it was completely melted, and I've got some footage of that. I was out here at night while it was snowing. Yeah, we had about 6 inches, 7 inches almost of snow in the past few hours, and this dish is clear. It has melted itself. If we look at everything else around here, we have a good 6-7 inches of snow, but the dishy is looking okay. I tried to film some speed tests out here just now, but it's a little too much in this weather. So I'm going to go inside real quick and get on the computer and record a couple of speed tests in there. I'll put them right here. All right.
So here's the download test. This one's pretty good ping, 24 milliseconds, downloading at 155, 160, 152 average, uploading here in the 20s. And see how it tapers off a little bit after it first starts. So it's going to average 15 megabits per second on the upload. And then the next one, this was later in the night. You can see that the ping speed was a bit worse, almost twice as bad, 49 milliseconds. Again, this is later in the night, 48 milliseconds on the ping. But again, the download is up in the 150s. Upload is 20, so still not that bad. And this is all during the snowstorm.
Keep in mind, I'm in the Pacific Northwest, and so it was snowing here, and it was only about 27 degrees Fahrenheit. The dishy itself was staying about 54 degrees Fahrenheit, and I've got some IR footage that I took and some temperature probe with a Fluke meter that I took, and I'll put that in here as well. But yeah, what you have to remember about this is communicating with a low Earth orbit satellite, so it's only trying to go about 340 miles, whereas other satellite-based internets, they're trying to go all the way to geostationary satellites. So they're trying to beam the signal and receive a signal from 22,000 miles away. This one's only trying to beam it 340 miles away. So I can see where the other ones would be much more affected by weather. The speed on the Starlink varies quite a bit. Sometimes it's maybe 60 megabits per second, 70 megabits per second on the download. Other times it's 170 megabits on the download, but it does seem to be averaging maybe in the 90 to 100 nowadays. And I know that they might have turned on about 120 satellites since the last time I did a video. It's been 4 weeks or so, and so that makes sense that they might have brought another two payloads. They're launching about 60 satellites at a time. It makes sense that they would bring two more payloads online in the 4 weeks it's been. A lot of people asking about speeds. Starlink has stated that they're targeting 50 to 150 megabits per second on this public beta. They're targeting 20 to 40 milliseconds of latency. I have seen speeds right in there, and I've seen download speeds faster than that at times, 160, 170 megabits per second. I've seen the latencies average right in there, about 30 milliseconds. Now, they are saying that they are planning on getting the latencies down to like 16 to 19 milliseconds by the end of summer 2021. I'll put a link to that at the end of this video. The upload speeds have been averaging about 16 megabits per second. I was seeing 20 or a little bit more at times. It seems like when you first start uploading a file, it'll upload faster, maybe 24 megabits per second, but then it sort of, if you do it for any length of time, it will throttle back down to about 15 megabits per second. Seems to average about 16. Other people have asked about gaming. I'm not a gamer, so I don't know what latencies you need, but I will say that, like I've said before, that the latencies are 30 milliseconds or so, maybe a little bit less. I'm not sure how that would work with gaming. I guess it depends on the game, but the fast.com speed test that's built into the Starlink app shows the latency to certain servers, and I'll put a little sample of that up here. I think a bigger problem for gamers would be the unknown frequency of these 15-second outages. Like, you could be playing a game, and then in the middle of it, it just drops out for 10 to 15 seconds. And I could see where that would be a bummer in your game. Starlink all along has said that, you know, we will see those outages during the beta period. As they bring more satellites online, as they bring more ground stations online, those outages will go away. And it seems like they've become, those little outages have become slightly less already in the past 4 weeks. So I do believe that they will deliver on that. Some folks had asked some more technical questions about NAT and VPN. There was an announcement about NAT, and I will put that here. Keep in mind, you can use your own router connected to the Starlink system. You don't have to use the Starlink Wi-Fi router. A couple of people on my last video commented with a link to a particular website, and I'll put a little sample of it here. And this actually shows the satellites in real time, how they are covering the Earth. And if you zoom in on the sort of 44 or 45 degrees north to 52 or 53 degrees north, that band that Starlink is offering the beta service, you'll see that it's got quite heavy coverage. Twice now, I have been able to correlate an outage at our place and then quickly get on that map and look and see that there's three satellite circles, coverage circles, and I'm in the middle of an empty space. So the satellite circles are moving, and oh, yep, that's why I have an outage, because I'm in that 15-second little triangle between three circles of coverage, and that's why it's out. Starlink has called this the better than nothing beta, and it absolutely is that, especially if you have nothing else available. I had a lot of people that commented on the last video saying, oh, well, I can get Verizon or, you know, fiber to my house. Why would I pay $100, you know, saying that this is expensive? Well, yeah, this is expensive, but if your alternative is HughesNet or Viasat or any of the other sort of geostationary satellite-based systems, this is actually not that expensive for what you get. If you can get fiber to your house, that you're living in a totally different place than where we're living, and you have more availability. But to me, it doesn't matter what fiber costs, it doesn't matter what DSL costs, it doesn't matter what a cell phone hotspotting costs, because I don't have any of that available to me. But this is available to me, and so that's why we're trying this. I should also point out that, yeah, the costs in the U.S. are $4.99 for the hardware and $99 a month for the service. Our neighbors just across in Canada, their prices are $6.50 Canadian for the hardware and $130 Canadian for the service per month. There has been an update to the Starlink app, and now if you try to check for obstructions in the northern sky, instead of it showing a big circular view of about a 100-degree dome that you need to see, it actually is truncated and kind of curved along the horizon. And I'll show a clip of it here. What it means for us is that these trees that are on our horizon are actually not really as much of a problem anymore. They're outside of the zone. And I think that might be in part to more satellites being up. It doesn't have to sort of see ones that are lower on the horizon. There's more higher overhead. I'm not really sure what that means, but it is something that showed up in the Starlink app in the middle of December 2020. A lot of people have asked how to get on the beta list. Well, there was a link in the description of the last video. I'll put the link in this video as well in the description. But basically, you just go on starlink.com and you have to type in your postal code. Right now, December of 2020, it's only available in North America, in Northern US or Southern Canada, in a certain band. I did hear that that was updated to 45 degrees north to 53 degrees north. But again, there's only certain cells within that band that are available. And I'll put a link at the end of this video to a Starlink launch video where the engineer talks about those particular cells. A lot of people mentioned that, you know, once all these satellites are up, it's going to ruin the night sky. I think it's important to note that all the Starlink satellites that have been launched since September 2020 have had sunshades installed. So once the satellites are in place and the sunshades are deployed, those satellites should not be visible with the naked eye from the ground. The first couple of hundred Starlink satellites that were deployed did not have sunshades, and those ones are visible, but at least 60 of those have been retired and have been burned up in the atmosphere. Some folks had asked to see what the setup looks like, so I'm going to stow this dish. You can do that with the app. You can make it stow itself so it orients vertically, and that's the way that it ships. And then I'll power it on, and you'll see it orient and look for the satellites. So what do I like about Starlink and what don't I like? I really like the speed. The download speed and the upload speed and the latency, all that when it is running is really good. What I don't like is the short outages, the 10 to 15 second outages that you don't know when they're going to happen. It certainly affects if you're trying to do any sort of video call, conference call, FaceTime, any Zoom, anything like that. It'll just cut out and wait and wait. And then depending on the software, if it's Microsoft Teams, it seems to just drop it. If it's Zoom or FaceTime, it seems to hold it and wait. It'll come back because usually the Starlink service will come back before the software drops you. Another thing I really don't like is sometimes when the Starlink is disconnected from the satellites, the router turns off. It doesn't so much turn off, but the Wi-Fi of the router turns off. So if you're monitoring it and you just see your Wi-Fi go away from your laptop or your phone or whatever, it's like, well, why does the router turn off? And I imagine it's because remotely they are rebooting the router and they're probably updating software or firmware on the router and then rebooting it. And those outages tend to be a little bit longer, like maybe they're 30, 45 seconds. Sometimes you'll see a whole minute or so. And you know, what happened to my internet? And you look and it's not there at all. The Wi-Fi network is not there, and then it will come back on. And that's just disconcerting, and it's kind of a pain. So just as I believe in building community here in person, I also believe in building community on YouTube. And so I want to give a shout out to a YouTube channel that I really like, which is called Foghorn Station. I'll put a link right here. If any of you are looking for relaxation or just sounds to listen to, if you live in the city or you live somewhere and you want to dream about living on the homestead or being in the woods, check out Foghorn Station. She's got videos of just what it sounds like in the woods or just rain on a tin roof and really interesting stuff. So check it out. If you have any questions at all about Starlink or other rural internet options or homestead Wi-Fi, I'll be doing a couple of videos on that really soon. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications if you do. Thank you, everybody, and we'll see you next time. I did not cut this tree to put the Starlink antenna here. I had stated that in the description of the last video. This is south in this direction. We had cut a bunch of trees to get sunlight in here to our homestead. And this stump just happened to be in the right spot to get the northern view that the Starlink needs. So that's why I put it here. Keep in mind, we're in the Pacific Northwest, so trees grow really well here, is what we do well here. And trees are a renewable resource, especially here. And so we've planted trees in other spots. We're not going to feel the loss of this one tree, nor are we going to feel the loss of these other trees that we took for sunlight. Plus, I have a sawmill. I have lots of ways. We're going to use all this lumber. This is not going to be wasted. Thanks, everybody. I appreciate it.